All right, well, go ahead and get kicked off. I'm Scotty Burnick, landscape architect with Reagan Smith. Have Ralph Knausen here as well. Ralph is with South Star and Ben Shado. We have a few folks from the development team. Also, Lee Horn, civil engineer in our office, is on as well.
And then our president, Glenn McGee, just joined us just a minute ago.
So appreciate everyone's time tonight. You know, these meetings, I guess, especially being virtually, can still be sort of informal. You know, in years past, we would have a few minutes in the beginning to kick off and answer questions and sort of look at some boards. And then we'll give a quick presentation and then open up for Q&A. The last several of these we've done, we've sort of gone into more presentation mode since it's virtually. So with that said, I thought we would kick off and just go through some of the project elements. Here on the screen, this is an illustration of the RM development. Again, this is an approved project we'll talk about. It's an older illustration that was done in 2019, but shows some of the team members that put the initial package together and then some of the team members that are working on this round here. So the main reason for the neighborhood meeting, you know, originally this plan was approved in June of 2019 as a plan development. So what that means is it went through neighborhood meetings, joint conceptual workshops, submittals, planning commission, BOMA meetings. And it, so it went through the whole process and was approved. And tonight, and what we're doing, we're looking at, you know, future phases for this to be kicked off. And with that, we've looked at a specific phase and how it's going to be developed, getting more finite with the details of those buildings. And with that, and in our world, it's not uncommon to have a couple minor changes. With that, I wanted to sort of just quickly note what the changes are, which we'll talk about this evening. The first is really project phasing. I'll show you later in this presentation, but we are simply just rotating phase one and phase two. They're sort of side by side. And again, that's based off market conditions.
Hey, so Scotty, I think it'd be good just for people that maybe that aren't familiar with our initial approval, mm-hmm. if you would just go over the densities and the types of uses that we got approved
sure.
on the approved plan, because we're not varying from the approval as it relates to the types of uses and density. Yeah. I think it'd be just good to give a general overview of that.
Definitely. And tell you what, I'll even have a slide I'll pull up and sort of showcase that. The other reason for the neighborhood meeting on this specific block is to discuss building height. And then overall, I really just wanted to explore the improvements we've made with what we're now calling phase one of the multifamily block. Have a lot of improvements on there. And as Ralph was starting to allude to, what we're not suggesting or requesting or applying for is any change to any of the approved uses. Or where the uses were shown. We're not requesting any changes to the density so that the overall project density is the exact same as the approved plan. Same with the development improvements, same with internal ingress and egress around the development, you know, and same as the open space. So some of these key sort of bulk regs of the plan district development, if you will, are not changing. So with that said, let's sort of go through and talk a little bit about it. So our project, this is called REM. For those who aren't familiar, we're located at the intersection of East McEwen and Carruthers Parkway. I've highlighted it there with a yellow outline. Also, before I got really into the plan, just wanted to also quickly talk a little bit about layers. So, you know, when we went through the process originally, we had to comply with the land use policy. That's sort of this bottom layer. And the layer above that would be the zoning layer. And then sometimes you may have some overlays or layers above that. But essentially, you know, the area in purple, which is where we're at, is the regional commerce area. And again, this is a document that the city, the commissioners, BOMA members use, and that we as professionals and designers use to look at what's appropriate in a certain area. So essentially, this was a document that is not needed for the process we're going through now, but it really plays a critical role in understanding what the vision is for Franklin, where and how development goes. So the regional commerce area is a very high intent district within the city of Franklin. You'll see it's along the I-65 corridor there. And again, it's meant to sort of maximize development with existing infrastructure. Essentially, you have big corridors right next to this access to the interstate. So it's an area on both sides that was identified through a public process about this is the right area in which we do want to grow. And when we grow, we want to do it carefully. And as Ralph mentioned earlier.
You're saying slides. I'm sorry. I'm just wondering, guys, I don't see the slides, but I don't know whether that's just a...
Has anybody else seen the slides?
I can't see it, Scotty.
Scotty, this is Glenn, and I was just texting you and Ralph saying that I'm not seeing the slides either.
Okay.
So
let's try this here. Maybe first question is, can you see the slides now?
Yeah, there you go.
Now.
I appreciate
it. Yes, I can see it now. Yeah.
I appreciate y'all not letting me get to the end before you mention that.
I'm not real literate at this stuff, so I wasn't sure. Maybe it was just me, but I was texting you to ask.
Well, long story short, here's the project location. So in yellow, you'll see the site located on East McEwen. The regional commerce I was just talking about in purple, which now probably makes a little bit more sense, is located there off I-65, and that was the area I was talking about for the vision of the community, the residents, the city, and the city members. And then I think we're caught up to speed right now, so hopefully y'all didn't miss too much visually. This is an illustrative plan of the development that was approved in 2019. So this is a plan that we went through the process on. I mentioned at the beginning of our conversation. I wanted just to give you a little insight and some details about that plan, specific to what was approved, and give you a little context, and then we'll go into sort of what we're proposing to amend. So overall, this is a 27-acre site. It's a mixed-use development. It was zoned PD. So what that means is there were some special requirements, special stipulations, and level of detail that was provided with this plan when it went through the approval process. Overall, there's 480 multifamily units that were approved. You'll see those sort of as the brownish color on the left, and then sort of middle there. And then from a non-residential standpoint, again, mixed uses of commercial, but you have 750,000 square foot of office, 100,000 square foot of retail and restaurant, which would be sort of along that lower bottom floor. And then 700 keys for hotel. The hotels are sort of the pinkish color. The office is the blue. And some of that retail, which would actually be on the ground level, is illustrated sort of a light tan color. So a little over 1.3 million square foot of non-residential use, plus the multifamily units there. So,
and I might add, you know, 22 months ago in February, we were ready to kick off our first phase, which would have been different than what we're looking at right now today. For this meeting, we had already, we were going to kick off with a 250,000 square foot office building that was going to be a spec built building and two hotels. And we all know what happened in March. A month later, and you know, it's been a struggle to figure out what the market would bring to us and allow us to kick this off. We really want to get this started, and so it's caused us to reflect on what can we do, how can we kick it off, get the infrastructure done in those things, and the market is telling us we can at least come forward and do some more residential that's approved, and we're asking to do it in, you know, we want to do it in a place we've already got it approved in. So with that continuing on, please.
Yeah, and as I noted before, you know, the figures we're showing here now aren't changing. These are the overall figures. This is what we were approved and what we're still committed to doing, and no changes there. So really, we're going down to more of a block of this as we're looking at a specific building and how that gets built with some of those market conditions that Ralph mentioned. And again, I'm going to try and do an expanded view here. I'm going to click down. Hopefully, everybody can still see that. Let's see, Glenn, can we get a thumbs up if you can see the phasing? There we go. Okay.
All right. Good deal.
So, as I mentioned, we're looking at the phasing. Initially, our phase one was at the corner of East McEwen, where it is phase two. And we're simply just switching these around. So we haven't adjusted the uses that were approved or shown in those blocks. We're simply just looking at starting with phase one first. And part of the plans all along had a pretty sort of flexible schedule in terms of which phase went. But again, based off market conditions, looking at getting this first one kicked off, which is pretty exciting. Again, this is the overall plan that was approved in 2019. If you want to look at the multifamily building down here, the existing one, I'm going to flip the slide and you should be able to see how it's changed with this application. So there in yellow is the only block that we've been studying and looking at as part of this application, and that will be continuing to progress ultimately into construction documents here in the near future. This is a multifamily block, the same as before, but we made several really positive changes for the development. A couple of details that really matter and was sort of a part of the process is activating the streetscapes. What that means is having uses along your drive. So where you see Arium Drive, just up here to the top, Ovation Parkway, Arium Trail, and Golden Way, you know, what is that experience on the pedestrian level to really activate that streetscape? And I'm going to zoom in here while we're talking through this. Again, this was sort of the before and the after. But a couple things we looked at with the design team is one, you know, what makes sense as we're moving forward. So before, and I'll show you the before, we had a very large parking structure. It was elevated, that was exposed to the Ovation Parkway, had a few liner units at the top there, the multifamily units there to the right, and then down to the left. And as we've explored this and we've looked at it, we've tried to come up with some really positive solutions on how to improve this block as it moves forward into sort of the construction phase, if you will.
Well, and if I could add, I would actually applaud what Shadow Residential has done with Smith G in making some of these changes, because we really have found a way to set ourselves apart on this corner with a first class development with this particular multifamily design by adding a promenade through the middle of it, creating more pedestrian connectivity. We're essentially hiding all of the parking, which was exposed before a lot of it, by going subterranean or below ground with the parking. And we've made a tiered approach of one multi-level building that's five stories with a basement on one corner, and the other multi-level or multi-story building is going to be, it's actually going to be 11 stories with a 12-story penthouse slash amenity on top of it. The amenity for that building will be on the top of that building on the 12th floor. It's really, it's done so many things to provide a really upgraded feel to it that I'm very excited about what this can be. So go ahead.
Yeah, and I think to your point, you know, Ralph, as we look at this block, there's, you know, a certain amount of real estate, and how do you maximize it for, you know, parking and all these different elements that's important to a healthy plan. And on this one, you know, those details that, as Ralph mentioned, were pushing parking further subgrade. So by doing that, it's sort of out of sight, out of mind. It's not something that's a visual negative, I guess.
And, well, and it's far more expensive to build it that way. Yeah. I want to add that too. We're not sparing expense to build it that way. We're building it that way to make it a better project.
And what that does, though, is it really gives us flexibility on the surface level. So again, at that pedestrian scale where we're at, to not just activate the streetscape, but introduce a really, really nice open space in this initial block. The open space will provide an internal pedestrian connectivity from RM Drive down to RM Trail. And we have some illustrations to sort of show that. But again, keeping some of the amenities that were programmed before, which is in the courtyard, you'll see, there'll be a pool and some hardscape. But the element on the left, the large plaza, is a new plaza, and it's up and beyond the requirements for open space not being assigned to meet those standards. So it's sort of, sort of icing on the cake to really be able to have this ability. And we're able to do that with having the different levels of multifamily that works well with the scale of this development, and shifting the parking subgrade was the, sort of the biggest component of that. This is a multifamily unit that have right around 340 units. And again, all the parking that's required for it would be subgrade and will park itself. So that's sort of the initial thought. We have a mix of 1, 2, and 3 bedrooms, and that's pretty typical for a lot of multifamily units in these areas. There's some additional illustrations that you can see. We've talked a little bit about the top left one. It's another view and vision of the site plan. You'll see the multifamily sort of wrap on the right, the A2 at the 5-story with the basement, and then the A1 being the 11 with a 12th sort of penthouse and amenity. And what we say by amenity, having a roof deck amenity. So sometimes that could be a green roof or a hardscape, but really a nice additional space.
You'll actually have a pool.
For the residents.
It'll be the residential amenity.
For the residents to utilize. And then on the right are just subgrade illustrations of the parking deck. So those are below grade. I will note that on the top right, the bottom side of that, and I'll move the mouse if you can see it, there'll be a lobby and some leasing amenity area in that location. And what that's doing, as we'll sort of talk grades, we have a pretty good grade between RM Trail, which is a drive page bottom, to RM Drive, which is a drive at the top of the page. And in order to make that grade difference, we're doing that with the building, with the parking structure behind, and that bottom level will again activate a really, really nice streetscape for the residents. And then again, each level sort of grows. You can see level one, it sort of wraps around more as is exposed to the grade level. Level two, you'll see sort of that plaza that we've mentioned, illustrate right there. And how that works, if you look at the bottom right graphic, RM Drive, which is sort of above the building up here, which is sort of due west. It'll be at the same grade. So from the main drive on RM Drive coming in at a pedestrian level, it'd be flush, if you will, to be level with that streetscape. And the whole entire plaza will be level. And then towards the east side or page bottom down here, you'll see an elevation change to get pedestrians down to this streetscape. So what's happening is the building at the street level is activating that with the sort of the structured parking just beyond and underneath. And here's another view of the building. You'll see sort of the five with this basement level down here. And then as Ralph mentioned, this multifamily block that overlooks the plaza, the future development, which will be to the west of this, and then sort of the streetscape around. In regards to illustrations, this is some character imagery that we've looked at to really sort of show intent of these spaces. So the Promenade Plaza in the middle it's a really big deal. It's a space, again, that will allow a strictly pedestrian experience in there without traffic, without any of that. And it provides space for landscape, hardscape elements. Again, just you can be dealt with many ways and be a good area for the community to meet that and the residents that live there. And then the bigger picture to the right top, it's called the Spanish Steps. It's sort of a play on of a really nice piazza overseas, but essentially it shows the connectivity at the top level coming down to the bottom level. So we would look at that in a few different ways and how to get different residents down, but just sort of illustrates how that's being done. Again, the purpose of that is to create a really flat, large plaza for that main space. So with all the grade we have, this is an element. Again, showing sort of a rooftop pool terrace that Ralph mentioned. This is just an example of what we expect. And then some of the amenities that we'll see along that sort of bottom level. Last thing I want to point out is door stoops. And when I say activate the streetscape, what I mean is that there will be elements and not really a building's back won't be placed towards the street. So we've taken a lengthy amount of detail to really think about how the buildings look, how the aesthetics play a part in this. What is that feeling you have when you're in this neighborhood? And REM stands for is the golden standard.
That's correct.
And to put that into perspective, it's an important element we've looked at from the beginning conceptually when we got this approved in 19. And as we're looking on how to evolve this and make it better, we really want to sort of, you know, set a nice vista development.
Well, our development team really believes that this is the center of the bullseye where new development needs to be in Franklin. It's what Envision Franklin says it's where it needs to be. We believe this is one of the most important corners in the entire market, and certainly in Franklin and the Cool Springs area. And we want to set ourselves apart with something that's very special. And we're going to kick that off with a residential development that's going to start that process and allow us to move forward with other development in the future.
I feel like this illustration really speaks a lot. This is helpful as we look at scale of buildings and placemaking. So, you know, everything I'll say on the perimeter of this development from the far left, if we're looking at this top illustration along Carruthers, which would be right here, with McEwen being sort of on this right side, it really shows a nice dynamic of the mixed uses, the scale of the development. Again, this shows what's sort of been approved for that area with some 12-story buildings, 10-story, we have loft, 9-story. So with really nice central open space, it's a spine throughout the heart of this development. So again, worked with planning staff a good bit to make sure that we were in keeping with sort of the design elements of where the new ordinance is actually now. So although this is the old ordinance, there's a lot of really nice aspects and techniques that were utilized to really make this a nice experience. Just to sort of point this out, the development that we're looking at, this specific phase that we're talking about is right here. So before this was a larger mast building. You'll see here now it's broken up internally. That's where the plaza is, with this five-story with the basement level on the bottom side. And then on the left side here, you'll see the 11-story with the 12th being sort of the penthouse up here in the back. And then on top of the 11th, I guess on the 12th there would be the amenity deck with pool and all that. So that sort of paints a little bit of the picture. We're using sort of generic imagery to show form well, and passing of it.
Well, if you look to the left of that, your cursor left, that's the other residential that we have approved on the site. And that was approved at 9 stories for those buildings is what we came in with during that approval, and you need to anticipate them to be. They also sit on a hillside that is probably the equivalent of two or three stories taller than the other side of the street because of how it will be developed. If you cursor not to the right along Carruthers, the next the next building next to it where there was a hotel, right, that had a hotel loft level. So that was a 10-story building that was anticipated and what we had shown in the approved development. The office next to that right there is a 12-story building. So you can see we're consistent with what we've approved already, but we've broken, all we've really done is break up this one block into two buildings. But I did want everybody to understand that it is in scale with the approval. It is in good taste with how the overall development will move forward. I really think it's quite an improvement to it, having the promenade and the subterranean parking. And I really believe it's going to be something special. So,
yeah, agreed. I think before we go into Q&A, I just wanted to sort of note the process a little bit. Where we'll be, we'll have a joint conceptual workshop meeting later this week where we'll have a chance to do a very quick version of this, a little bit of a show and tell to just update the commissioners and any of the Bowman members that are there, as well as the community. And then we'll be working to make an initial submittal that tightens up the plans that we've shared tonight on December 13th. And then once we do that, we'll go through a staff review, which is required with all of these types of applications. We'll get comments back and then resubmit in January in efforts to be at the Planning Commission on January 27th of 22. So as we sort of talked earlier, the last time we went through the process was a lot more lengthy. It required us to go to BOMA because essentially it was a rezone. If this were to be a major revision, we would also have to go back and go through BOMA as well. So it's a different process. It's not as long of a process. But with that said, really wanted to open up for a Q&A. We're here available, I think, to respect everybody's time. We're here at least till 8 o'clock and happy to answer questions beyond that. I'm going to go back to the plan just to sort of pull it up, and I think it could be helpful as we sort of talk through some of these elements.
Yes, let's open up the Q&A.
Hello. I don't know if anybody... I just had a quick question about, when I was reading the background of this project, I saw that it was approved in a version of this approved in 2016 or 2017, and then it was held off because I saw that there was I saw an article, that said that it had been, that there had been like site challenges and that there with the elevations, and so that there had been a proposal earlier.
There was a project that was approved on this site, but that approval took place, I believe, in 2014 or 15 when the former owner owned the project. When we purchased the land in 2017, and this is the only approval that we've taken through the process. So to the best of my knowledge, for a mixed-use development, this is the only time one's been shown on this corner.
Okay, I'm sorry, yeah. That's,
I can't tell you our final approval date was literally June or July the 1st of 2019. That's when we got this plan approved. It was a 2-year process to even get to that
point. Okay. To your point, there is a lot of development that is programmed in this area. In keeping with Vision Franklin and all that. So perhaps it may be one of the other developments regarding emissions and site challenges.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions, anybody?
I wanted to double check. the name of a gentleman from Rag and Smith with the red sweater. I'm sorry. I think I typed it down on it, but I want to make sure I don't.
Actually, I'm Ralph Knaus. I'm actually executive vice president with South Star, and one of the key people in our company that handled the development process hand in hand with Glenn McGee, who's on.
I wonder whether you guys, whether South Star could tell me, you know, with what they're saying about the office, you know, the commercial rental market, you know, having had some problems, or at least it's not hasn't recovered as quickly as the retail market. I heard they were talking about that for Williamson County. You know, like I'm wondering whether, you know, the 700,000, really you feel like the office rental and leasing market is due for a rebound. I'm wondering whether there was any, you know, to say about the way, you know, the recent sort of market trends, you know, just the stats that have been quoted to me in the short time I've been on this job, talk about how, you know, office space was the part of the market which was had the most, had not recovered to the extent that they were hoping.
Martin, I'd love to actually have Glenn McGee address that. Please, Glenn, yes.
Yes, Martin. Martin, are you with media?
Yes, I'm with the... Yes, I'm with the Franklin Brentwood Community Impact Newspaper.
Okay. Yeah, you know, it's I think you really what you've brought up is a lot of the reason why we are where we are right now, right? I mean, we pretty much had spent a lot of money, development plans, working on construction documents, those kind of things, and I could carry you through a lot of information, but essentially sitting in our office in January, February of 2020, about to kick this project off. And of course, we all know what happened in March of 2020. And like a lot of projects, we put the brakes on this. And so we have spent a lot of time in the last 2 years, really, trying to decide what to do. Well, excuse me, about a year and a half, right? And we've drawn new site plans. This is a very expensive piece of property. And we're going, where is the market? What will the market bear? How can we get this kicked off? How can we get it graded? We're also up against the clock with the city of Franklin because, you know, plans expire now. Zonings expire. And so they have a sunset date. And so while we didn't want to make a decision and just start to start so that we missed that date, we certainly wanted to make sure we did what was right. And so that's what you see here, right? The market's changed somewhat. If you look at what Chartwell has done and coming up with a great product that really sets itself apart from the entire market and doing something really creative with this residential, really is going to set us apart. And so consequently, what's happened is we've moved away from kicking off the hotels first because they're coming back. They're not back yet. And really, the same with all everything else. So while we're not necessarily making a prediction today of how much office we'll do, we're certainly have our finger on the pulse of the market. And quite frankly, I think we're in one of the best markets in the country, and we're going to start to see that maybe before some other markets. But there's no doubt about it. To your point, Martin, we're sitting on a lot of sublease space in Franklin that's going to need to be absorbed. And you know, the good thing that we feel is we can get some of the components in place that will be attractive to offices, such as residential. That's a big deal for offices today when they relocate. They love these mixed-use developments that have these pieces integrated into it, and residential is one of the top components, right? In addition to the retail, the hospitality, entertainment, et cetera, et cetera. So we felt like that we knew we could get it kicked off with this, the demands in the market, we're going to bring something special to the market. And then we're going to really continue to see where that market goes. And by the time we get this done, the site's developed, and we start to add some of those other pieces, we're going to have a lot better feeling of where that market's at. We're having many more conversations today than we were 6 months ago, certainly even more than 3 months ago. So we feel pretty bullish about the future, but we're not going to go spec build, as to your point, a 700,000 square feet of office out here anytime soon.
And we don't want to build the wrong thing in error of the market. I mean, we have one of the most desirable markets in the United States of America. We have major corporations that are still looking to relocate here and are going to continue to in the future. We're all, as a nation, still trying to figure out, well, how many work at home and how many work in an office, and what's the office environment going to be? And I think we're getting there, but I don't know that we're there today. But we have a great piece of real estate. It's in the center of the bullseye where Franklin Development needs to happen. Franklin wants it to happen. And we want to make sure we build the right thing that's going to stand the test of time and be a really, really special development. So that's all I want to add.
And just for me, to when you reversed the phasing, it looked like the arrow was going from the multifamily to the what had been the parking deck project is not happening. Or was there a parking deck that was being built next to the multifamily that's going to
actually the phase one where the cursor is right now,
right?
Hotel and an office product that wrapped around a parking deck that was going to serve that, and then a future office just to the bottom of the page that was to the actual east of it. So that was a large parking deck that was being wrapped to facilitate that development. The hotel business came to a screeching halt during COVID, and the office business came to a great slowdown during COVID. And we've always had multifamily in the segment that we're going to still want to build it in. We just want to be able to build the multifamily now while we have a market to do that, so that it'll allow us to kick off all the other critical infrastructure we need to facilitate ourselves and put ourselves in a position to develop these other products as the market returns and we know what the market is.
Okay. So yeah, it seems like it's like in one sense, the sort of the migration and people coming to here for the favorable business environment. These are things that I've heard commonly described as encouraging to, you know, the idea of building commercial space and new residential properties. Yeah, I mean, I guess you're going ahead because you know that there's a lot. I just want to link, you know, that this prod that you guys are thinking in terms of like the migration or the new corporate headquarters, just to be as explicit as possible, you know, that you're really thinking the multifamily residences will find the supply will meet that demand, and that's the thrust. I know I'm stating it for you, but that's, but that's why I'm just curious, because I want to be able to put it in that context. I pretty much have it in that context, but I just, yeah, the fact that new corporate employees, you know, who want a certain life, you know, they want the walkability and to be in a kind of like a very mixed environment, you know, that this is, you think that this will be good for them.
Actually, over the last few years, it was called live, work, play. It gives you the opportunity to do everything and get a vertically integrated mixed-use development that you can walk and you can park your car and walk around to all the various uses. We still believe we have that. We just need to see how the market comes back for us to know how it's going to develop now as opposed to how we initially planned for it to pre-COVID.
Okay. And ideally, when do you think that you would start, think that you would build that this first phase of the multifamily building?
It's our intention to go right into the site plan approval process, the city of Franklin, for phase one, which is going to be this multifamily product together with a masquerading and master utility package for the overall site. And we would start construction sometime late spring, early summer, either late May or early June, and to stay within our initial development approval deadlines that we need, you know, that we'd like to meet. I mean, we have the ability to ask to extend that. We don't know whether the city would entertain that or not. Our preference is to keep the deadline that we have already gotten approved and make that happen. So that would allow us to actually be starting the multifamily building approximately 6 months later after that, going into the winter of 2022.
All right. And so it's basically you're hoping that this will get back, the amendments will get through the Board of Aldermen and the Municipal Planning Commission.
Actually, such a small amendment, it's a very minor change. We are only going to Planning Commission. That's all we are required to do. That's all we really need to.
Oh, okay.
And that meeting and approval, our intent will be to hopefully be on the January meeting. So the last week of January of 2022, we'll have that approval and be able to move straight into site plan. That's our whole intention of what we're doing. We are just respecting the process, and we made a change to the plan. Even if it's minor, we still have to go through the process. So we're respecting the process and doing what we need to do.
Okay. Is it possible to say what you think the pricing will be on the units? You know, what the range might be when this?
I don't know that we can address that right now. Honestly, I'm okay. Not sure. Right, there's so many factors involved in that. I know that it will be a market rate development, but I can't tell you what the market rate will be. And I don't even know what construction price is going to be a year from now when we start the building.
Right. Yeah, that's what you hear.
We've dealt with a lot of that change over the past 2 years as well. So.
And one more thing. It's Mr. McGehee, you're a title. Mr. McGehee, what is your? He's an executive vice president. Ralph is, and what's your title?
I'm president, and
go over.
Okay. All right. And how many units in this first building? I heard you say
we are proposing 340 units in this building.
Okay, that's what I heard. Okay.
480 we have approved for the overall size.
Okay, that's 340 though, that what you're going to build.
340 is what we're proposing in that block.
Okay. So, and do you know what that represents of what, you know, they were talking about a $700 million project. Is that, you know, can it be said what, you know, you think that investment is for that building in the ballpark?
And you're probably more keen and in tune with that than any of us as it relates to that specific project. And you want to lob a number out that you feel comfortable with?
It'll be approximately $95 million.
Okay.
Thank you, Ben.
Okay, yeah, I'm sorry. Anyway, I just wanted to make sure, I think I might write an article about this project coming up. So I want to make sure I kind of had my...
Oh, Martin, I apologize. I just misspoke. I'm having a little deal merge. It's been a long day. Did I say 90 or 95?
95.
So it's 90.
Okay.
It's still a very substantial investment on one piece of this development to kick it off for certain.
Okay. All right. I think I got covered a lot of bases. If I have any follow-ups, I'll try to write to you at South Star, get in touch with you, but I think I'm pretty good.
Thank you, Martin.
Thank you. Are there any other questions out there?
Chelsea, do you have any comments or anything that you need to make or want to make? I know we had our pre-op meeting this morning.
No, I don't think so. I think you guys did a great job explaining kind of what we were wanting for Thursday, to reiterate, the joint conceptual workshop for this project will be on the agenda. So, Martin, if you're interested in coming to that, you're welcome to be there also.
It will be a much abbreviated meeting compared to tonight's meeting, though. I can assure you, Martin, we've got a 20-minute opening to present and take questions from the board and mayor and alderman.
Yes.
And the planning commission.
So. That's the 9 a.m. meeting, right? Or is that the 4:30?
It's a 4:30 meeting.
It's the 4:30 meeting.
Okay. So. Yeah, I have to see because I'm getting all this other onboarding training. So I will try to attend that. Thank you.
All right. Well, I don't believe anybody else is on that has any questions. Unless you object to it, Chelsea, I think the meeting can be concluded.
I think that sounds great.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Good night. Thank you.